I'm gonna make a little seasick walking around.
Just in case you're wondering, Ben's watch is a little early. So we have to wait now for 10 o'clock so the spirit can lead Dennis to welcome us.
All right, welcome to UCC Parker Hilltop. If this is your first time with us this morning, we do have visitor cards. Just like any other church, we do ask if you are comfortable filling that out, place that in the offering plate. If you're not comfortable filling that out, completely up to you. We do have some announcements this morning. The first one is on August 26th is the Castle Rock Pride. Our church does have a tent there. And if you are interested in attending or helping out in any way, please contact Angie Law. Her email is on the back of the bulletin. Don?
Okay, this is the last of my peach shirts. So I've run out of peach shirts, but we haven't run out of peaches. So we have done really well. We had brisk sales yesterday out in the parking lot, and of course all the pre-orders. So I'll start with the pre-orders. They are downstairs and Mark, those who bought boxes, we have put your name on them. Please see my granddaughter Isabel and let her know that you have taken your and have her give you her box anyways, just so that we can keep track and make sure that we know who didn't pick them up. We also have peaches left over. We have a couple of 10-pound boxes and 15 or 18 pounds to sell by the pound at $4 a pound. If you need a couple of extra peaches or a box that you forgot to order, we will take care of that downstairs in the back of the fellowship hall after church. But we're in the black, so the peach sale is a success. And what more can we say? Thank you.
Does anyone else have an announcement this morning? Going once, going twice. All right. Let us join together as a community as we welcome the light.
Saints, see no reason we should dream that the world would ever change. Saying love is foolish to believe, because there'll always be some crazy.
Thanks, Ben. That was great, as usual. Thank you. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Please join me in the call to worship. What does the Lord require of you?
Justice, and love, kindness, and love, humbly, for our God.
What does God command of us? God does not call us to ease or to comfort. Let us worship the God who believes in us and trusts in us and abides with us.
Let us worship the God who asks much of us, but who believes by us every step of the way.
We're looking at hymn number 2. In the red hymnal, please. And I don't think this is enough. Maybe, yeah. Okay, good. You can stand if you'd like to.
This time, we'll ask our next generation to come up. All right, go ahead and introduce yourselves to the congregation.
I'm Nora.
I'm Jesse.
Izzy.
All right. So, do you have any idea about what today's sermon is about?
I'm guessing love.
Mm-hmm. Right, but more specifically. Nope, you didn't get any helps from the home team? All right. All right. Have any of you ever watched or heard of Mr. Rogers?
Yes.
Okay, you have not.
Maybe.
All right, well, we are going to watch a video now from Mr. Rogers, and it is from the 1960s. He had been on the air for a very long time. And it was during the 60s, and do you know what was happening during the 60s? The Civil Rights Movement. And so during the Civil Rights Movement, Black people, people of color, were fighting against Jim Crow. They were fighting against discrimination, and they were trying to go into public pools. But when they did that, they were met with opposition and people that were wanting to hurt them, and people that threw acid and pool chemicals into the pool to try to keep them from doing that. And this was Mr. Rogers' response to that.
Oh, there's Officer Clemens. Hi, Officer Clemens. Come in.
Rogers, how are you?
Fine. Why don't you sit down?
Oh, sure. Just for a moment.
It's so warm. I was just putting some water on my feet.
Oh, it sure is.
Would you like to join me?
It looks awfully enjoyable, but I didn't have a towel or anything.
Oh, you share mine.
Okay.
Sure.
Oh,
hold
man.
On. I'll put some more water in here.
Oh. This is going to turn into a beautiful day.
You like bare feet?
Yeah, as I grew older, I liked it more and more.
Uh-huh. Good for you. You're pulling up your pants. I forgot to do that at first.
Oh, I don't want them to get wet.
Right.
That feels great. You know, when you're a policeman, you do an awful lot of walking, and sometimes your feet get tired.
Right.
That feels better already.
Good.
Just massage it a little bit.
Cool water on a hot day.
Well, thank you for your refreshments.
Oh, I'm glad you like it.
You're welcome, Officer Clemens.
Mm-hmm. Is that enough?
Oh, that's fine. Mm-hmm. Well, that was so enjoyable. I'm sorry I couldn't stay longer.
Well, I know how busy you are. But sometimes just a minute like this will really make a difference.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Who can put your hand in my hand and be ready to feel all safe and strong? You're a child, so you can do it. Children do it all life long. There we are.
You have great boots to fill, Officer Clement.
Well, thank you very much. Well.
Thanks for stopping by.
So long.
Have a good day.
Bye-bye.
All right, now grab a magnifying glass from the table. All right, what did that clip make you think of? Did it spark any emotions from you?
It seems like, well, he was saying that everybody should be treated equally and that everyone should get to use the pool or whatever.
Mm-hmm. What else? Anything else? So what Mr. Rogers used his platform for on PBS, hold up your magnifying glasses, is he was magnifying love to the world. And at a time where this was risky for him, it was taboo for our culture, he displayed to children, to parents all over the world, that we are to love our neighbors. And he was teaching us how to love people despite the differences of the color of our skin, our cultures, and things of that nature. So what he was teaching us to do was to magnify love into the world. So let's say our prayer. We are wonderful.
We are wonderful.
We are kind.
We are kind.
We are brave.
We are brave.
We are loved.
We are loved.
Yay, God.
Good morning. I've just been told that Shirley is still not feeling very well, so she's not here today, even though her name is in the bulletin. And there's one other correction that I owe an apology to June and Jean for. I looked at the list for the fellowship, and it said Jean, and I thought it said Jan, J-A-N, and it said June. Jean's sister. So it's not Jan Narachi that's co-hosting fellowship. It's Jean's twin sister, June, who's here visiting. So, and if you are visiting and would like to fill out one of our visitors cards to either be put on our newsletter list or to receive more information about our church, we'd appreciate you filling one of those out, and you can just put it in the collection tray when it comes around. One great joy we have today is Shirley Alsager. Where is she? Oh yeah, there she is. Shirley Alsager is on Zoom with us today.
Hello.
Hi, Shirley. We ask for continued prayers for Charlie Toma, for Gary Ebert's mom, Mary, for Joan Bond, for Kelly, Desiree Galloway's cousin, and also for Diane Sanders, Jeff and Desiree's very good friend, for Jack, Jan and Joe Narachi's grandson, and for Nicholas, Peggy Lundberg's nephew. Since they were here last week, many of you may have chatted with Carl Bailey, but Heidi informed me that Megan has been seizure-free for 5 weeks now. and they think they finally got the right combination of meds to control her seizures. And in her words, God is very, very good. For those of you that remember the Bailey's family friend, Cade, Cade had cancer. He had been taken to Houston in June, and he did pass away last month. So Cade is Megan's best friend from Adams Camp, which is a camp that allows children with challenges to have the adventure of a lifetime. And it is a true adventure camp. I mean, these kids are zip lining and going down chutes and ropes courses and everything else with the help of the counselors. If you get a chance, take a look at it online, Adams Camp. It's really quite amazing. And it's right here in Douglas County. So Heidi said that Kate's family is very strong. They have a great support system, but prayers for all of them as they go through this really, really challenging time. Does anybody on Zoom want to share anything?
I'm just so happy to see everybody. Love you, love you. I'm surviving and I'm happy.
And does anybody have anything that they'd like to share here? Ben?
All right, for those of you who don't know me, I'm Ben Jenkins. I have something bigger than a joy, something like a miracle. So 2 days ago, I just got hired at McDonald's. I just had two shifts already, so all I could say is God is good. So thank you.
All right, Ben.
Wonderful, Ben.
That's who we are.
Hi, I'm Jean Shearer, and my sister June is here, June Rasta from Reno. And if any of you follow Dick's Facebook page, he writes about everything. Junie fell into a cactus patch yesterday afternoon, and the cactus did a number on her. So be gentle to her this afternoon. We're still working on getting out all those stickers. So anyway, it's wonderful to have her here.
Thank you. It's wonderful to see you.
Yeah, I'm gonna jump in. We have two grandkids that I'm just extremely proud of. You see Isabel every week here. Yesterday she gave up her Saturday afternoon and she came over and helped me schlep peaches out here in the parking lot. And was no end of a good sport and good help. She weighed peaches and hauled boxes and everything. And I can't be more proud of her than I am. And our grandson, Matthew, who is in Minnesota, and has his own difficulties. He's on the autism spectrum and is deaf and anyway, has lots of issues and social issues. I competed in a local Special Olympics event in equestrian events, and he took two silvers and a bronze. So we're just extremely happy for him. But thank you for sharing my joys.
Anything else? Thanks.
Sue. We've got a Zoom now.
Sorry about that.
Go ahead, Al.
Al, go ahead.
Oh.
Nope, okay. All right, so let us be in a spirit of prayer as we sing hymn 39 in the Worship and Rejoice, the red hymnal.
Where to charity and love abide, God is dwelling there, God is dwelling there.
We find it so easy to give lip service and check service to the commandment of love. We can say we know your love and that we respond in kind, but we far too often do not respond in loving ways towards others. We write checks to support ministries of compassion without ever truly feeling the deep compassion that service demands. Let us sing.
Where true charity and love
dig deeper into our souls, O God. Expose the vain selfishness and the fear that seem to block true discipleship. Engage us in ministries of justice, in which the kind of love that you call us to have is required, not just in our spoken word or in our offerings of monies, but in our very compassionate nature. Free us and inspire us to love all persons, those whom we would deem unlovable, and those whom we find it easy to love. Help us love ourselves, respecting ourselves in gratitude for the gifts you have given to us. Then move us to use these gifts in service to you. Let us sing.
Where to charity and love abide, God is dwelling there, God is dwelling there.
Jesus is a light shining in the darkness of our world. Teach us to love one another as you love us, so that we may bring peace and joy to the world. Hear our prayers, both spoken and unspoken, this morning, as the disciples were taught to pray. Our Creator, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our wrongs, as we forgive those who have wronged us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture reading today comes from Matthew chapter 22, verses 34 through 40, from the English Standard Version. The Great Commandment. But when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together. And one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? And he said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Here ends the scripture. May God bless these words as we seek to apply them to our lives.
So last week, we explored the concept of the church being a shining city on a hilltop. And we are in a four-week sermon series. This is the second week, preparing for our bridge minister that will come and help us lead us into the next section of our journey until we find a settled minister. So in this morning's text, we find Jesus being challenged. Last week, he was talking to his disciples and he was giving them a challenge about how they should be the light of the world. They should go out into the world. They should be that shining example in the world. But in this week, this text, we find a very different situation. We go from him trying to hide from the crowds because he was tired from healing people and ministering to people. And this week, we find in the previous chapter that he went into the temple. He found money changers. He found merchants. He threw over tables. He shoved all of these people out of the temple. And then the religious elite came to him, and they were wondering, who is giving you the authority to come into our temple and to throw all of these people out? And so rather than answering their question, he asked them a follow-up question. Well, John the Baptist was baptized. Who gave him the authority? Was it God or was it man? And they mumbled amongst themselves and they're like, well, we can't answer this question because if we say it was God, then he's going to ask us, why didn't we believe in John the Baptist baptism? And then if we say that it was of man, all of these people believe he's a prophet and they're going to be mad at us. So they, to avoid the question, they simply say, we do not know. And they did not get an answer from Jesus. Then after this, we see the Sadducees and the Pharisees, the religious elite of the day, see that Jesus is causing problems for them, calling out what they're doing. And they continue to try to trip him up by asking questions about anything from taxes to the laws of Moses. Jesus was able to silence the Sadducees, so the Pharisees go and they get together and are like, hey, you're a lawyer. We need you to ask him a question. You're a lawyer. You know how to debate. You know how to get through these things. So they go to him and they ask, what is the greatest commandment? And not only does Jesus answer the question for what they were looking for, but he adds to it. And he says, love your neighbor as yourself. Basically, in a nutshell, love God, love others, join together. Now, if you're wondering why I show interesting videos that you may or may not agree with, and you're wondering how does this fit into the sermon, there's a word in there that I heard a... Honestly, I try to choose the cleanest version of everything that I can show because we are in church. But I also want you, and I didn't realize that word was in there. So it was a shock to me as well. But I try to give us a glimpse beyond these four walls into the world and seeing how they view Christianity and giving us a different perspective than what I can give you and what you may be able to obtain yourself. And so that's why I do it, is to give us a glimpse into the culture, into what's going on. Now, Dolly Parton, as you may know, classically does not like talking about politics. She tries to stay out of that, and it has worked well for her. Then she was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and decided that she is going to earn that right, and so released a rock album, and that was one of the songs on the rock album. Do you know how bad things have to be for Dolly Parton to write a song chastising all of us about how we have lost our way? And ultimately, what I get from that song is she is basically telling us When did we lose in God we trust? Essentially, when did we start hating each other? When did we forget to love each other? And anytime that I talk to anyone that might be on the conservative side of Christianity, I can't keep my mouth shut, and I start a conversation with them. I don't know why I do that, but I do. And basically, what ends the conversation is, well, you know, even when I was a conservative independent Baptist and we believed all these crazy things, is I still held this thing true. Love God, love others. At the end of the day, if you don't get anything out of the Bible but this, is to love God and love your neighbor as yourself. That is it. That's all that matters. Everything else is trivial. We watched a movie on Netflix called The Jesus Revolution. It talked about during the 60s and 70s, kind of probably what gave birth in the mega churches. And this very conservative pastor in a dying church didn't understand the hippie movement. And then his daughter brings home a hippie for him to meet and to talk to. And so he invites him into the church, and then they start changing things. But the thing at the end is his daughter, near the end of the movie, his daughter sits down with him and he says, you know, before this all happened, I was done with Christianity. So basically, as soon as she was going to turn 18, she was going to leave the house and she was never going to return to church. And what she said to her father, at that table in this movie was, I just looked around and I just questioned, where is the love? Where is the love that Jesus was supposed to represent? So last week I challenged you that we all have a light within us that we need to go out into the world and we need to share. This week I am challenging you to take the love of Christ with you, and to take that love and to love your neighbor unconditionally. What if you don't agree with them? Did Jesus say, only those that voted exactly like you did on that ballot initiative? No, he said to love them. What about the person that plays loud music at all hours of the night? Love them. And I think a lot of our problems would be solved if we just forgot about the things that divided us, and we just focused on seeing people as they are, where they are, and we showed them love. It would be transformative for our church, it would be transformative for our community, and it would be transformative for our world. And luckily, we have an opportunity in the coming weeks to go to the Pride Fest in Colorado Springs and show a marginalized group of people that there is a congregation that represents Christianity and that can show them love as well. So that is it. That is the sermon. Go forth and love your neighbor as yourself. Amen.
Just a clarification. I think it's in Castle Rock, not Colorado Springs.
Oh, sorry.
You know, that's okay. Yeah, close enough. It's in Castle Rock. Jan and I will be there, as well as hopefully many of you. We're on page 560 in the red hymnal. I love to tell a story. I hope you love to tell a story, because we've got one to tell.
Story of unseen things above. to tell the story, 'tis pleasant to repeat what seems each time I tell it more wonderfully sweet. I love to tell the story, for some have never heard the message of salvation from God's own holy word. I love to tell the story.
Well, I forgot to mention in my joys this morning that Isabel actually turned into a teenager this week. So I'm not sure whether that's a joy or a concern, but I just wanted to make you know, be careful, watch out. Today's prophets don't write letters and gospels, they sing. The Beatles tell us, all we need is love. Kermit croons, but if you'll believe in love, that will surely be enough. And long before these prophets sang, Jesus taught us to love our neighbors as ourselves. As we prepare to pass the offering plates, both real and virtual, I ponder how our church on the hilltop demonstrates love. Sure, we're open and affirming. That's love. We are a church that demonstrates an extravagant welcome, perhaps overly so. Love? Using our time, talent, and treasure, our calling and caring ministry keeps a loving eye on our members, offering prayers, assistance, and compassion to those in need. We're good neighbors. We keep our grounds and our environs tidy. And we support a wide variety of charities, local, national, and worldwide. Could we do more? Should we do more? Is our love like our light hidden under a basket? I leave that answer up to you. How do you contribute to the love that radiates from our church on the hilltop?
Thank you.
Oh, my goodness.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Our closing hymn, number 557, Pass It On, in the red hymnal. Receive the blessings of God. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord shine his face upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Go forth and shine your light into the world. Amen.